G'day ladies and gents, and welcome back to War Thunder. Today, we're going to be having a look at the best plane in the game without guns, the all-missiles, all-sort-of-brilliant naval jet, the Sea Venom. But before we talk about the Sea Venom, I'd just like to quickly mention something that I find extremely important. For those of you that exist on the Twitch sphere, you may know Jean-Claude Van Schott, and Jean-Claude Van Schott's mother has been extremely sick lately. In fact, so sick to the point where he's gone to look after her in hospital and is actually doing a lot of the stuff that you would traditionally think nursing staff might do. Things like giving medication, things like feeding, things like pressure area care, which, you know, you turn your patient every so often so they don't develop bed sores. They're doing that sort of stuff, and as a result, Jean-Claude is not live streaming. He's been away for a little bit. So for those of you that have Amazon Prime or that have Twitch Prime or that are subbed to me, I would advise you to use that Twitch Prime next time around on Jean-Claude Van Schott. He's definitely in a hard spot at the moment, not necessarily financially, but honestly, giving him a little bit more financial support will help take those worries away for sure. And I think that's the best way to give him some support, as well as, of course, rallying behind him on all social media and Discord and things like that. So, ladies and gentlemen, do keep Jean-Claude Van Schott in your thoughts and send him a Twitch Prime and send him some love, because he really needs it at this point. But moving on from that, it's pretty hard to move on from that, to be honest. It's a bit of a morbid note, but we're going to have a look at the Sea Venom. And the Sea Venom is one of those planes that is that sort of dinky little thing. It's not particularly competent, and it is not an all-round plane. But I tell you what, in the little niche that it exists in, it is hilariously fun. This thing is not necessarily bad, but it's certainly not meta, and that's one of the things that I really like about this plane. It's probably better off as an event vehicle or as a battle pass vehicle. I think this would have suited it better, but of course being a premium is okay too. I wouldn't expect this thing to come to the main tree, because basically it's a... I don't know. I genuinely don't know. It's kind of like a mix between a Hunter, a Venom, the Buccaneer, and the Lightning in a way. It's a very strange mix of a lot of things, and it just sort of reminds me of the absolutely thriving aviation industry that was sadly killed off in the 1950s and 60s by the British governments at the time. Very, very sad, because this thing would have been an absolute pearler if you had just given it a few upgrades. Can you imagine this thing like afterburning or with a twin boom tail instead? You just couldn't imagine it. But the Sea Vixen is one of those planes that is fun. It's actually fun. Is it worth the money? Well, let's have a look at the gameplay and find out. So, from what I can gather by the way this plane looks and feels, it seems like it's more of a bomber interceptor. Traditionally, a fighter interceptor or an air superiority fighter of some sort would have guns, but this thing doesn't get guns. In fact, it's so good that it doesn't need guns, ladies and gentlemen. It's just a pure Chad plane. It's just one of those planes that exists and just eliminates everything with those red tops. Being battle rating 8.3, you do see all the way down to 7.3, which is kind of crazy. These missiles are kind of strong. They're not great in terms of range, but they certainly are in terms of their tracking ability and their damage. These are very, very strong rockets and or missiles, rather. And as the IL-28 found out, it is pretty damn deadly when you come into contact with one of these. Not often do you survive a red top, just because of the sheer volume of explosives in these things. But because of that, you do have that trade-off of them being a little bit on the either heavy or slow side. They don't have great range, and that's the problem. They're not an AIM-9G where you can fire them out from 3 kilometers and you're guaranteed a hit. Even in some cases, with slow-flying enemies, you might be able to get kills with AIM-9Bs from 3 kilometers, or about 2.5. But with the red tops, you're going to be struggling at anything beyond about maybe 2.5-3 kilometers. Anything around that margin, it's not going to be a guaranteed kill, and you are going to have some issues. Now, the Sea Venom is not a plane that turns very well, so you are going to have to be using your speed, which you do have plenty of, but you're going to have to be using it, and you're going to have to be looking for enemies that are distracted. And this is your ticket to those so-called high kill games, or those games where you're going to get a lot of action. And in this case here, I've managed to basically pick off a couple of planes that aren't really concentrating or that aren't really aware, and you're firing from sort of that 2 kilometer range or that 1.5 where maybe they can hear some aircraft noises and maybe they can figure out what's going on, but if they're just distracted that badly, then you are likely going to get a kill. Of course, this thing sees all the way down to 7.3, but of course also sees all the way up to 9.3, so it is some planes are, you know, fairly used to red tops now with the English Electric Lightning, but still don't learn their lesson. J2 taken out quite handily by things like the red tops. They're pretty damn good missiles, especially at higher altitudes, but of course at those lower altitudes is where most of the dogfights are going to be happening, and that's kind of just the way War Thunder works. You can't really get the best of everything in this case, because that's the way War Thunder works. But the Sea Venom is actually still fairly okay. Like, you do have things that you can do in a Sea Venom. You just can't get caught out. You can't get sort of surprised. You have to always be on the front foot. And the moment you sit on the back foot is the moment that you start to lose in the Sea Venom, because you're the one who's supposed to be on the offensive. You can't just reverse someone, because you need the distance of about 800 meters for the red tops to start tracking. Because if you don't, you're going to end up with basically a missile that just flies straight. It doesn't have enough time to get itself onto target. And that's kind of what I'm looking to do here in this engagement, for example. I'm trying to push up so that as soon as I can be behind this MiG-17 AS. But it turns out this guy is pretty much AFK, and I'm basically going to get a free kill. But honestly, is that really a bad thing? I don't really think so. The Sea Venom isn't one of those planes that is meant to be super competitive, and its fun factor is actually fairly strong. It's not one of those planes, of course, that you're going to be acing every single match, and of course, there are plenty of matches where I have died without kills, but I tell you what, there are so many more matches that I've had where I just get, you know, a couple of kills, and the team either stomps or we just generally have a good time. I don't really... So far, I haven't had any of those matches where I've needed to carry, but you do need a team, and this thing would likely not be a good carry machine. Just because it doesn't have guns, and it doesn't have that ability to get really close in and do a lot of damage with, say, Aidens. If it had, like, 2 Aidens, it would be absolutely perfect, but I think, judging by the way these intakes are, the Aidens had an issue with the gases in the cartridges. So, obviously, when you fired the gun, or the cannon, the bullet would travel out of the barrel, and the gases would follow suit. And sometimes, I know this was a thing with the CAC Sabre, the guns would actually cause engine flameouts, or compressor stalls, or something like that, where you actually wouldn't get your engine back. And so, maybe that's the reason why they decided to not go with guns, because I guess maybe a bomber interceptor doesn't really need them, but it would be really nice to have them. Even as pods, like similar to the PV2, if it had some pods like that, or the SK-60, that would have made it a really, really nice dogfighter, or something similar to the Buccaneer, but with guns, something similar to the Hunter, kind of. It was, the Sea Vixen is that weird mix of planes, and for me, that's where the charm is. It just would benefit so much from those extra guns. But you know what, you can't get the best of both worlds, and this is a plane that is extremely iconic, so I'm willing to forgive it just for that. So we're looking at the MiG-17 here, and hopefully this guy is distracted enough to get ourselves a nice little kill. Again, I'm going to be prepping the missile, and because he doesn't have RWR, there's every point in the world in using that radar to slave the red tops to that MiG-17. Now, I've noticed that he's diving a little bit, and that might be my opportunity. The MiG-15 is looking at me, but decides not to go for me at the last second. And of course, now I'm in a situation where I might need to get myself a quick kill. This Sea Vixen was quickly, unfortunately, met with a pretty stern little missile, the R3S. And I'm about to send this R3 a beautiful little missile in the form of the red top. The Lightning was great for its red tops, and one of the things that the Sea Vixen really shines with is having those 4 missiles. If the Lightning had 4 missiles, it would be so, so much better. But the fact that the Sea Vixen is 8.3 and has all of these missiles available to it makes it just a little bit more deadly, and kind of, in a way, makes up for the lack of guns. Although, don't get me wrong, I have already harped on about it a lot in the, 10 minutes that this video has already gone for, but my god, would it have been nice to have some guns. Still, this plane is definitely a lot of fun, and that's kind of the thing with the Sea Venom. Sea Venom's not a lot of fun. The Sea Venom is pain, or at least was pain. But I'll tell you what, the Sea Vixen is very, very fun indeed. Don't be expecting to, like I said, carry matches, but I'll tell you what, this plane, when you get some enemies that are distracted, is absolutely a load of fun. Is it worth for grinding? Well, I don't think so. If you're going to grind, what you need is something that is hyper-consistent. Now, the Sea Vixen is not exactly consistent, simply because missiles are not always guaranteed kills. Of course, guns are not guaranteed kills either, but I'll tell you what, guns surely do give you more opportunities for kills than missiles. Consider it like this, you have 4 rounds of ammunition, and that's what you have to work with in the Sea Vixen, whereas if you had, say, the Hunter F1, you had plenty of ammunition to work with, and as a result, you can pretty much get some kills and still have ammunition left to spare, whereas with the Sea Vixen, you might actually spend all of your missiles before getting 1 or 2 kills, which is not good for grinding. What you want is consistency across the board, and that's why a plane like, for example, the F5C, which we'll see a video on later this week, is really, really good for. Now, FJ4 decides that he wants to go for a head-on. Because I don't have any guns and because my missiles are not all aspects, at least not in War Thunder, I have been told that they are in real life with radar slaving, but I don't know what to think, and it might be because the plane needs to be supersonic, so in this case, we're really not going to be getting any dice from the subsonic FJ-4B. Anyway, because I have so much speed and I have those two, I believe they're Avon engines, so same or similar engines to those in the Hawker Hunter and the Blackburn Buccaneer, I have plenty of speed, and so the FJ-4 really doesn't stand a chance in a running fight against me. And so what I'm going to do is slowly circle back around in order to help out my team with some other vehicles here. And of course, the wise decision by the FJ-4 is to discontinue the pursuit and go and look for something better. Mainly because that Hunter is also starting to close the distance on him, and, you know, Hunter versus FJ-4, in an energy fight, the Hunter should always win that. Anyway, I'm looking now for other enemies that I might be able to target. And of course, you need to position yourself where you're going to be really selective about your targets. You can't just go for an enemy that's just sort of whatever, because the enemy needs to be distracted, they need to be close, and they need to be traveling in a weird angle to you. No head-ons, they need to be traveling basically dead-on in sort of line with you. And things like this MiG-15 Bis here, just not happening. He's too fast, and he's just sort of sitting at too much of a distance. Now, this MiG-15 is also not going to be any good, and this is where the problem lies with the consistency of the Sea Vixen. Just because of these, that is why I wouldn't recommend it to grind. Of course, if you're going to be having fun in this plane, by all means, go for it, spend the money, have the fun. But you're not going to be getting majorly consistent results, and of course, there is a limited amount of things you can do in this plane. And this is kind of what highlights it the most for me, is when you have so many targets, but you can't engage any of them because your missiles do not cater for this. And that is the real issue with bullet bill with wings here. So, we do have ourselves a little bit of an opportunity here with the MiG-15, who is looking at our little friend in the Sagittario, and, oh man, come on, give me the lock. If he gives me the lock, then I will be able to get myself a nice kill. The MiG-15 has gone into the vertical, which is an extremely big mistake, and that 16G overload on the red top gives me some great work. Now, I'm turning around, and I've noticed that there are a lot more enemies than I thought there were, so the fight is definitely not over yet. There is an A-Saber and a MiG-15 barreling towards me and the Sagittario, so we have our hands full, and we have some work to do. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort of, it looks like I'm going to ditch the Sagittario and Super Mistair? Some sort of Mistair. But I'm really just looking for a better opportunity to launch a missile. Now the A-Saber there looks pretty damn distracted, send off a red top, and of course it makes a beautiful connection. So we have that MiG-15, and the MiG-15 is starting to head down towards us, but of course he has no missiles, and I can continue flying in a straight line because I am faster. This plane, 8.3, I think might be a little bit too low. I think 8.7 might be better, but of course it's very, very limited. in its capabilities, but when it does get those capabilities available, it is extremely potent. So we have a MiG-15 chasing us and a MiG-15 4 kilometers away from us. So if we decide to just pull into a vertical, we're dead. But I'm going to go for a little bit of a climb, wait for someone else to sort of get their hands on that MiG-15, and then barrel around. The other MiG-15 has dropped down to deck, which gives me a lot more of an easy chance, because the first turn this MiG-15 makes is going to put him in at slow speed, and is therefore going to make him at a very, very easy target. I go for the MiG-15 that is in a little bit of a climb, and of course, the red top tracks beautifully, and I get myself another kill. That's 3 for 3. Can we make it 4 for 4? This is exactly where I want my enemies. I want them distracted, and I want them low and slow. And my team is doing an excellent job of keeping them low and slow, allowing me to shine. And for me, whilst this is pretty fun and is enjoyable, just because it's a bit of a novelty, it's a bit of a dinky plane, and it's not exactly the most competitive thing, this isn't a plane that should be dominating teams. If you get like 6 Sea Vixens, you're going to have a pretty shitty time on your team, and a shitty time is that Sagittaria, because unfortunately, I launched my missile just before the Sagittaria sets him on fire. I feel really bad. I feel so shit for stealing kills sometimes. Sometimes I'm angry and I steal kills anyway, but I really shouldn't. It's best practice to not steal kills. Be nice to your fellow War Thunder players. They're also grinding, whether it's footage, whether it's RP, lions, modifications. Someone's always grinding, so it's always nice to be nice, even though it might not benefit you. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the Sea Vixen. I've called it the Sea Venom about 3 times, but it is definitely the Sea Vixen, and it is a beautiful plane. The guy that got me into War Thunder, who I used to fly model airplanes with, he had a Sea Vixen, and I still remember his first flight in that radio-controlled Sea Vixen. He spent about 3 minutes, and he's like, yeah, I'm really enjoying this. And then he spent another minute, and his voltage readout read, I think it was 2-point-something volts, which is below the 3.3-volt voltage cutoff. So he ended up with a dead stick landing and a little bit of a hard landing. But I'm pretty sure that that thing is still in a cupboard somewhere and is still gorgeous. The Sea Vixen is a beautiful plane and should absolutely be treated like one, but don't go rushing out to buy it because you think it's going to win you games, because it's really just a novelty deep down inside. Anyway, ladies and gents, thank you very much for watching. Please go and subscribe to Jean-Claude Van Schott, either that's on YouTube, Twitch, etc. He is a fantastic bloke and deserves all the support that he can get. Anyway, ladies and gents, thank you very much for watching. Take care, and I'll catch you next time.